Welcome to the lecture on lexical analysis, part 3. So, in part 1 we covered the basics of lexical analysis, the motivation, etcetera, and we covered the theoretical fundamentals, finite automata, regular expressions and transition diagrams in part 2. Today we will continue a little more about transition diagrams and generation of lexical analyzers, and then study lex, which generates lexical analyzers. So, to do a bit of recap, transition diagrams are generalized deterministic finite automata, but there are a few differences. The edges may be labeled by a symbol, set of symbols, or a regular definition. Some accepting states may be indicated as retracting states, and when we reach a retracting state, we really do not consume the symbol which brings us to that particular state. And then with each accepting state, there is an action which is executed when that state is reached. Typically, we use this action to return a token and its attribute value. But very important, transition diagrams are meant for manual translation and not for machine translation. So, let us understand how exactly transition diagrams can be translated to lexical analyzers. So, the first transition diagram we will be considering is the one for reserved words and identifiers. So, this is a fairly simple and straightforward transition diagram. We start in state 0, then on a letter we reach state 1, we keep on consuming letters and digits in state 1, and when we finally get some other symbol other than letter or digit, we reach state 2, where we return the token code say for the reserved word or for the identifier itself. So, how does this really translate to a program? So, the lexical analyzer is called get token, and it returns a type called token. So, inside the lexical analyzer we have two local variables, my token and c. So, there is a while loop which runs until the end of file, so which has a switch on the state. So, to begin with, we will always be in state 0, and then for this particular transition diagram we will be in state 0, and as we read a character in state 0, if it is a letter we change to state 1, otherwise we report it as a failure. That is because here the only legal character is letter, and in state 1 we check whether it is a letter or a digit after reading a character. If so, we remain in the same state, otherwise we switch to state 2. In state 2 we have actually we have got ready to announce a token. So, the symbol which brought us to state 2 is not consumed, it is pushed back into the input. The token is obtained by searching the table of tokens. So, if it is a reserved word, then the reserved word token is returned by the search token, and if it is an identifier, then we simply get the string corresponding to the identifier, put it in my token dot value and return my token. Similarly, when we want to catch constants, various types of constants, hexa, octa, etcetera, etcetera, we start in state 0, and on little x or x we go to the hex constant part, and on d oct the octal digit we come to the octal part. We keep consuming digits here until we reach return a token. So, this is the scheme both for hexadecimal and octal digits, or rather constants. So, this is fairly straightforward. We remain if the character is a 0, then it is an octal constant. So, we go to state 4, and if it is not a 0, then it is a failure because it is an illegal character. And in state 4 we check whether it is an x or x. So, it could be a hexadecimal constant or it could be an octal constant. So, instead if it is hexadecimal we go to state 5, and if it is octal then we go to state 9. And So, the two constants hexadecimal and octal are separated by, you know, one of them the hexadecimal is prefixed by x, whereas the octal constant is not prefixed by x. So, if neither of these appear in the input, then it is a failure. In state 5, we go on checking the for the hexadecimal digits, and we go to state 6 on receiving a hexadecimal digit. We remain in state 6 until we get hexadecimal digits, and then we either go to state 8 or state 7 depending on the qualifier presence or otherwise. So, here again, you know, we return the token called integer constant, because hexadecimal constants are also integers. So, after and we evaluate the hexadecimal number and return its value as the attribute of the token. So, in state 9, we do something similar and check the octal digits here. So, and finally, we return int const and the evaluated octal number as the token and its value. So, for integer constants, it is even simpler, any number of digits are consumed and then the qualifier or otherwise is checked and we return an int const. So, the integer constants are very easy, we check whether it is a digit, otherwise it is a failure, we consume digits, and finally, in state 15, we get the return the integer constant token along with its value. So, this is an overview of how the transition diagrams are translated into you know, lexical analyzer programs. But there are some reality checks that must be done here. So, we actually saw program segments corresponding to different, you know, transition diagrams. So, these transition diagrams must be combined appropriately to make a big transition diagram, and then that transition diagram will have to be translated to manually into a lexical analyzer program. Unfortunately, combining the transition diagrams is definitely not trivial, and it is possible to, you know, one possibility is order the transition diagrams in particular order, say transition diagrams for reserved words, then constants, then identifiers and operators. Try each of these transition diagrams in that order. So, in other words, the programs are also listed exactly in that order. So, when there is a failure, it goes to the next transition diagram and starts looking at that particular diagram. So, if this is followed, you know, this is fairly easy to program. However, this does not use the longest match characteristics. In other words, the word THENEXT would be an identifier and not a reserved word then followed by identifier EXT. So, it should not be rather, but what happens is if you actually order the transition diagram for identifier first, the next would be an identifier, but if you order the reserved word transition diagrams first, then you know you would have the reserved word then followed by identifier EXT. Really, in reality, it is better to use the longest match. So, in fact, the next should be identifier rather than then followed by identifier EXT. So, how do we get this longest match? The transition diagrams must be tried in, you know, all of them must be tried, then all the matches must be recorded and the longest match must be used. So, if this is done, or if the programmer is able to order the transition diagrams appropriately, in either case the longest match can be used. Using lex to generate lexical analyzers really makes it easy for the compiler writer. So, we will see how this works in the next few slides. So, now, you know, so far we saw how to generate regular how to generate lexical analyzers you know, manually using transition diagrams. This that approach is fine as far as small lexical analyzers, small languages are concerned. However, for professional languages such as C, C++, Java, The lexicalizers are very difficult to write by hand. So, there is a language and corresponding tool available for describing lexical analyzers. So, Lex is such a tool available in Unix. So, Lex has a language for describing regular expressions which are at the heart of lexical analysis. So, you just write down all the regular expression specifications for each of the patterns that we are going to detect in lexical analysis. Then it generates a pattern matcher for the regular expression specifications which are given to the Lex tool. And once it is done, the Lex tool generates programs which are appropriate for the lexical analysis. We are going to see how this is done. The general structure of a Lex program is that you have definitions, we will see what these are, then we have what are known as rules, and finally, we have user subroutines. Out of these, definitions are optional, but rules and user subroutines are essential parts of a Lex program or Lex specification. And on a Unix system, how do we use Lex to create a lexical analyzer? So, you just type lex ex dot l and it creates a C program by the name lex dot yy dot c. Then compile the program using GCC, it produces ex dot o, and ex dot o is your lexical analyzer which carves out tokens from its input. So, now let us see how exactly a simple lex program looks like and then go into some details. So, here is a comment, Lex specification for the example, this is a C style comment and we do not have any definitions in this particular program. So, between these two percentage marks, we have the patterns and then we have a little bit of user written code. So, this is very simple, there is a main program which calls Lex and there is a YY wrap program which wraps up the lexical analysis. And in fact, YY wrap hardly has anything unless we want some files to be closed explicitly. We will see examples of this a little later. Coming back to the rules section or the patterns section, this is a pattern A dash Z plus, which stands for any of the letters A to Z. Any number of times, one or more. So, this is a set notation A to Z. So, all the characters A to Z are in that set and A to Z plus implies any of these characters any number of times, once or more times. So, if this pattern is detected, then the echo statement generates echoes the pattern which is rather the text which is matching this pattern. And then it prints out a new line character. Dot slash bar slash n indicates dot indicates any character but new line, and slash n indicates new line. So, if in the absence of a match here, all other characters are actually matching here and we ignore them. The semicolon is just empty code, so it ignores all other characters. So, here is a sample. So, we have input here which contains both lower case and upper case characters, but the output filters and produces only the upper case characters. So, that is very easy to see. So, A to Z plus matches all these W, E, U, etcetera, etcetera, and then for each of the matches it prints out the characters which match and followed by a new line, where and it ignores all other lower case or any number characters, etcetera, etcetera. The definitions section of the Lex program, it contains we have already seen regular definitions. So, they are similar to that, there are regular definitions written here and there is also some code which can be included for initialization and other purposes. So, definitions are like macros and they are actually like shorthands. So, and they have the firm name followed by its translation. There are two simple examples here. The name digit really stands for the set 0 to 9, and the name number stands for the, you know, the digit pattern which is defined here, followed by digit star, which implies 0 or more occurrences of digit. So, here we are writing a regular expression digit digit star, and the digit part is defined here. So, these two together define a number as 0 to 9 followed by you know any one of 0 to 9 followed by any one of 0 to 9 0 or more times. So, that is the number, and this is the you know definition for that number. So, when we use such definitions, it becomes easier for us to write bigger regular expressions, as we are going to see very soon. So, any code for initialization etcetera that we include here, any variables that we want to use are all included between this percent bracket and percent bracket. So, that is the initialization part. The rules part, it contains the is the heart of any Lex specification or Lex program. It contains patterns and it contains C code. So, a line starting with white space or material enclosed in the percent bracket etcetera is C code. So, any C code lines are copied verbatim to the output, they are to the generated C file, they are not changed in any fashion. And a line starting with anything else is a pattern line, that is inside the rules section. So, pattern lines contain a pattern followed by some white space and then followed by some C code, which is optional. So, that is here. So, there is a pattern followed by some white space, then there is C code. So, this C code and the initialization C code are all copied exactly in the same order to the output C code file, there is no change at all. So, what happens to the patterns? The patterns are nothing but regular expressions. They are first translated to NFAs, then the NFAs are converted to DFAs. So, we have not studied the you know particular algorithm for optimization of DFA, but let me tell you that DFAs can be compressed and optimized, so that they are compacted and optimized. The number of states of the DFA, the number of transitions they make etcetera can all be made you know optimal, and it so happens that you can find for the same language any other NFA or DFA will always be optimized to a particular unique DFA. So, these DFAs are stored in the form of a table and a driver routine as well. So, this is easy to understand. The driver routine on a particular state looks up the table and then finds out what the action is and performs that particular action on that symbol. The action associated with the pattern is executed when a DFA recognizes a string which brought you to that particular final state. So, once we reach a final state, we may want to announce a token, and that can be done with the help of this particular action. So, now let us go into details of the syntax of Lex and then take up adequate number of examples to understand them. So, strings in Lex are nothing but concatenation of various characters. So, integer, then A57D, hello, these are all examples of strings, any symbols which actually you know can be put together and made into a string. But there are some operator symbols which need to be handled in a special way. So, for example, the double quote, the backslash, the square brackets, this caret etcetera etcetera, have a star plus mid this you know bar etcetera, they are all special operators. We are going to understand their work and note you know usage as we go on. So, to begin with, this the backslash is an escape character. So, if you want to use any, in its usage is similar to that of C. So, if you want to use any of these special characters in your string representation, then you can say backslash question mark or backslash dot to get that particular dot as a character into a string. Now, very important, notation is that of character classes. So, we have the left bracket, square bracket and a right square bracket. Anything which is enclosed in between is a character class. So, inside only the backslash, the dash and the caret have special meaning. All others are just characters inside the set notation. So, for example, the notation minus plus in one square bracket pair, another pair contains 0 dash 9 plus. So, this stands for, so minus plus is a set containing minus or plus, and 0 to 9 plus is the set containing 0 or 1 or 2 etcetera up to 9 followed by plus. So, this is a regular expression, as you can see. It starts with either minus or plus followed by any of the digits any number of times. So, similarly, A to D, 0 to 4, A to C. So, this says any character A to D followed by any of the character 0 to 4 and finally, any of the characters capital A to capital C. So, this is the set of characters corresponding to this regular expression notation. This notation says caret A B C inside the square brackets. So, this simply says it is a complement operator, all characters except A, B or C. So, A B C as usual stands for A or B or C, and a caret in front complements the set, and so it says all characters A except A, B or C, and this includes all the special and control characters as well. So, two more examples, plus backslash minus followed by 0, 5 plus. So, as I said, this backslash minus really stands for the minus operator itself. So, it is either plus or minus. So, here the difference is the minus started in the beginning. So, it was actually understood as the minus character, but here we wanted to make it the second character, which cannot be done because it is used to when it is used as a second character, there should be a third character as well. So, to get rid of this problem, we use a backslash in order to put this minus character. So, and the 0 to 5 plus is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 or 5 plus. So, again caret A to Z says all characters which are not letters. So, this is A to Z is all lower case characters, capital A to Z is all uppercase characters, and the caret complements them. So, it all characters which are not letters. So, that means all the digits, special characters etcetera are all included in this set. There is a dot operator which matches any character except new line, and the question mark operator is used to implement the epsilon or null string option. For example, A B question mark C stands for A followed by B or epsilon followed by C. Then we also have repetition, alternation and grouping characters. So, A B bar C D plus question mark E F star. So, this is a regular expression which stands for. So, observe that we have used ordinary parentheses and not the square brackets. So, A B is the string A B, C is the string C, D plus stands for D any number of times. Then the question mark says epsilon in place of any of these. So, that is bar epsilon, and then the EF star says EF repeated any number of times. So, that is the EF star. So, this is the regular expression notation in the ordinary form, whereas this is the lex notation. There are context sensitivity operators as well, slash then the caret and dollar. So, if we use caret as the first character of an expression, then the expression is matched only at the beginning of a line. So, for example, if you say caret AB is the pattern on its own, remember the caret character inside the square bracket has a different meaning. This is outside the square bracket. So, this means line beginning with AB. So, it is matched only if the line starts with AB. AB dollar, the dollar is the end of line, end of it matches only the last if the line ends with AB. So, dollar, if the last character of an expression is dollar, then the expression is matched only at the end of a line. So, then the look ahead operator is a little more complicated. We want to say that DO is a pattern which should be matched, provided there is a pattern following it and the string matches this particular pattern. So, that is letter or digit star equal to letter or digit star comma. So, if this entire big pattern matches after the DO, then DO is a pattern, is a string which is to be pattern which is to be matched, not otherwise. So, in that sense the slash operator is a look ahead operator which looks at all the pattern which is following, but it does not consume the symbols which match the following pattern. Okay, it consumes only the two characters D and O, the rest is going to be matched again after the DO match is finalized. What are the actions of LEX? For example, the default action is to copy input to output. So, those characters which are unmatched. So, if there is no match, it just copies it to output. So, we need to provide patterns which really catch characters, that is our purpose. And what is caught is retained in the buffer YY text. So, echo actually empties the YY text into the output. YY link contains the number of characters which have matched and whose character string is present in YY text. So, LEX always tries the rules in the order written down and the longest match is preferred. So, remember we discussed this longest match requirement in the lexical analyzer and the transition diagram part. So, for example, here this is a word integer and here is a regular expression corresponding to any lower case character A to Z plus. So, corresponding to it the integer is action 1 and corresponding to the second one is action 2. So, if you have a minor variation and we say it is integers, then really speaking integer, there are several possible matches. Integer matches the first part, the S matches the second part. It is also possible to match the entire thing integers in the second with the second pattern as well. And since the longest pattern is always used, this is the pattern which actually matches our input integers. So, now let us start looking at several examples to understand how exactly LEX performs its matching. So, in fact, the files which contain these programs are all mentioned here, EX1, 2, etcetera, etcetera. So, they will all be available in the NPTEL repository and you can download them, compile them and execute them to see whether the output is generated properly, try with different variations and so on and so forth. So, for example, this is the program which we already saw. So, let us not discuss it once more. It captures all the uppercase characters in the input. So, A to Z plus is printed out along with a new line. So, this is the input. So, all the uppercase characters are printed out along with new lines. That is a fairly simple and straightforward program. So, let us take another simple example. So, the first pattern says beginning with any number of blanks, 0 or more blanks, followed by a new line. So, this is the pattern. So, in other words, the simple explanation is all blank lines. Okay. So, they may contain a blank space character or they may contain only a new line character or they may contain several blank spaces followed by a new line, but in essence they must all be blank lines, completely blank lines without containing any other character. So, if this is the pattern which is caught, it is ignored, there is no action corresponding to it. Then if the remember the ordering of these as well. Okay. So, if it is a new line character, the new line is echoed and the variable YY line number is incremented. Any other character apart from new line dot star, any number of them is caught in the third pattern. And when this matches, it prints out YY line number corresponding to that particular line and YY text which matches the pattern dot star. So, this is printed out. So, the YY wrap routine does nothing, it just is required for to complete some formality, and in the main program we initialize YY line number to 1 and call YY lex. So, the way this operates, the in the input all the blank lines are ignored, and then since the longest match is, suppose there are non blank lines containing other characters as well along with blanks, then they would match this, but the new line will not match dot star. As I told you, dot matches only all characters except new line. So, all the characters all the lines which contain non blank characters will match this first for all the non blank characters except new line, and this next for the new line character. So, between these two they print out the characters and also the line number. So, let us see how the input is transformed to an output. So, here is a non blank line, this is another non blank line, then we have a blank line, then there are a few blank spaces followed by non blank characters, another blank line, non blank line and another non blank line. So, overall there are 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 non blank lines. So, we have 1, the first non blank line, 2 followed by the second blank non blank line, 3 the third, 4 the fourth, and finally 5 the fifth. So, remember the blank characters which are here in the input are also copied. What is important is that they contain non blank characters. Suppose we had after this a couple of blanks followed by a b, this particular line would still be written out as all this followed by 2 blanks or 3 blanks whatever is the in the present in the input followed by a b. So, the blanks in the non blank lines are all copied as they are, but if the input is a complete blank line, for example, the third line here and the fifth line here, they are complete blank, they are not copied to the output, they are ignored. So, this is what this was supposed to do, all the non blank characters got here, the new line got here, but all blank characters blank lines got here. So, now the example becomes a little more complicated. So, here we have a code part in which we describe there is a declaration called file star declare file. So, we have declared a file variable for use in our actions later on. And then we have a remember the this declaration is a user written code and it is enclosed in these two special markers. Following that are a number of declarations rather patterns. So, finally, let us go to the next page first. The in the rules section what we have is a regular expression called declaration, which is explained in the previous slide, we will come go back to it in a minute. So, whenever a declaration is caught, it is printed out to a file called declare file, which we have already declared, and what is printed out? The corresponding text which was matched. In the YY wrap routine, we just call f close to close the declaration declare file variable, and in the main program we open the declare file for write purposes and then call the lexical analyzer. So, let us look at the output and go back to the patterns after that. So, this is the input, this is the matched output, and this is the rejected input. So, as you if you look at the matched input which is printed out as output. So, we have float cd comma ef right, and then we have int ght comma as jhew 37 comma fuir comma gj 45 followed by semicolon, and then we have a float ire comma dehj 80 semicolon. Now, let us see what happens in the, what is present in the input. There are a number of you know variables here followed by semicolon, then there is int a b comma float c d comma e f, and then another set of characters, another int g h d etcetera. So, in this input which seemingly seems to be meaningless, there are actually some C type declarations. So, the purpose of the lex program that we are now going to discuss is to extract these meaningful C declarations from this seemingly meaningless input, and the rest of it is ignored. Okay. So, this is the our exercise. So, let us see how we can do it. So, there are a number of shorthand notations that we write down. For example, blanks. So, blank or tab. So, observe the you know backslash escape character for tab. So, blank slash tab. So, blank or tab any number of times. Letter is any lowercase letter a to z, that is the notation for set anyway. The digit shorthand is 0 to 9. Then an identifier would be a letter or an underscore followed by a letter or digit or underscore any number of times. So, this is the standard you know pattern for identifiers that we know of, any letter followed by letter or digit star, but we have also included the underscore here. Then we have a number which is one or more digits, so digit plus. This is the regular expression notation digit digit star. Then we permit an array declaration part which says an identifier followed by the left square bracket followed by a number followed by the right square bracket. So, observe that this is a pattern which uses patterns declared before. So, in other words, for the array declaration part we must have a name followed by a number. So, that is exactly what we have in our output here, name followed by number, name followed by number etcetera. So, that is the array declaration part, and then the shorthand notation declaration part says either an array declaration or a simple name. So, the simple name is you know any name that we have already seen here. For example, this GHT, IRE, DEH etcetera are all you know FUIR etcetera are all simple names. Then the declaration list, basically it is a number of declarations. So, declaration part followed by any number of blanks, and then there must be a comma, any number of blanks again, and then you know followed by this entire thing, declaration comma is repeated any number of times including 0 followed by declaration part. So, in other words we want to generate a list of declarations. So, this helps us in doing that. Then a complete declaration would be beginning with the reserved word int or float followed by a declaration list. So, this gives us something like this, you know float cd comma ef, int ght sghw 37 etcetera etcetera. So, this is the int, this is your declaration list containing either a name a simple id or an array declaration part. Okay. So, separated by these semicolons and ending with a separating by commas and ending with a semicolon. Okay. So, each of these is repeated as in any number of times. So, there is one declaration here, another here, third here. So, you can have as many of them as you wish. So, that is our declaration, and then we have you know the pattern in the rules section, which is a declaration. So, here this is what we are looking at, this is the declaration that we know of. Okay. So, any number of them. So, declaration whenever there is a match for the declaration, it prints out that particular declaration. Okay. So, observe here, each declaration has int r float followed by a declaration list. Okay. So, this is one declaration. So, whenever this declaration is followed by, of course, a semicolon here. Okay. So, whenever this declaration is matched in the input, it prints out that particular declaration into the declaration file. All others are characters which are ignored. Okay. So, now let us see how it works here. So, this sequence, you know, is a sequence of characters. It is an identifier, but then it suddenly ends with a semicolon. We are going to start processing it as a declaration only when it starts with int or float. So, this part is ignored. So, this starts very promisingly with an int, then there is an identifier also, and then there is a comma as well, but then suddenly, you know, instead of a semicolon we have a float. So, therefore, even this sequence of characters is ignored and copied into the rejected part, whereas again it starts with a float. So, a new declaration pattern is you know, going to start here, and this happens to be a correct declaration because it says float cd comma ef semicolon. So, that part is separated out as a declaration. So, after the semicolon it ends. So, we start processing a new declaration if possible. So, this entire thing does not correspond to a declaration because it does not begin with int. This begins with int. So, int ght asjh ew 37 foir comma gj 45 and semicolon. This entire thing is a valid declaration. It is copied to the output as valid. This is invalid. So, it is rejected. This is valid. So, it is copied here, and this is invalid. So, this is also rejected. So, the example really shows that for processing or catching declarations in a programming language, you know, you can actually write Lex programs for it. Even though we are going to do this more meaningfully using YAC a little later, that is after we learn parsing, we will see how to do all this using YAC. Which is actually a more meaningful way, but it is not as if Lex is less powerful. Lex can do quite a bit of work. It can actually catch all the declarations in the program, etcetera. That is simply because the declaration part of a program is really regular in nature, you know, it is corresponds to a regular language, whereas when we get into a nesting of statements and records, etcetera, it does not happen to be a regular language anymore, and we will require a more complicated machinery. Now, we move on to the next example that we have, that is the, you know, how do we combine identifiers, reserved words, and then hex constants, oct constants, normal integers, etcetera, etcetera. So, I told you that this is a fairly intricate problem when we dealt with the transition diagrams. So, let us see how, you know, you are writing a Lex specification simplifies this problem and makes it easy for us to write the specification. So, this Lex program also has an initialization code. So, we have a variable hex which is initialized to 0, variable oct which is initialized to 0, and variable regular which is initialized to 0. Then we have a host of these patterns, we will discuss them shortly. So, here are a host of these patterns corresponding to reserved words and then the other constants as well, and finally, you know, a main program which calls y while x. Okay. So, let us also see the input and output and understand it before we discuss the patterns. So, obviously, this is the input and this part is the output. You or me happens to be a simple identifier, it is caught as an identifier. While is a reserved word, so it is printed out as a reserved word. we have 0, 3, 4, 5 L A. So, out of this, it actually the 0, 3, 5, 4, 3, 4, 5 L happens to be an octal constant 229, but the A part is a simple identifier which is printed out as an identifier. Similarly, we have 4, 5, 6 U B. The 4, 5, 6 U part is a normal integer 4, 5, 6, and the B is an identifier B. Here is a hex constant 0, X, 7, 8, 6, you know, L. So, this much is a hex constant 1926, and then the HABC part is an identifier. And now, watch this, we have B followed by 0x34. Here it is not recognized as B, an identifier followed by a hex constant, because of the longest match characteristic. B followed by this entire sequence of 0x34 is actually matched against an identifier, and it is denoted as an identifier. So, you know, this is how the longest match is useful in identifying various tokens. So, let us go back to the patterns and study them in full. So, here is a letter which is already well known, A to Z or A to Z followed by R underscore. So, any little lower case or upper case character or underscore is a letter for us. Digit is 0 to 9, digits is digit any number of times, one or more. Digit octal is just 0 to 7, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 or 7. Digit hex would be 0 to 9 or A to F. So, any of these are hexadigits. Integer qualifier is U, capital U, lowercase l or capital L. Blanks, as usual, blank or tab any number of times, one or more. Now we look at identifiers. So, letter followed by letter or digit star. So, this is a well known regular expression for identifiers. Then we have integers, digits followed by integer qualifier optional. So, this question mark, remember, implements epsilon. So, this is really speaking integer qualifier or epsilon. Okay. Digits followed by integer qualifier or epsilon would make up an integer. Hex constant is 0 followed by either, this is, remember, this is square bracket xx square bracket. So, either little x or bigger x followed by hexadigits any number of times, once or more, followed by integer qualifier either, you know, or epsilon. So, we have 0 followed by x followed by any number of x digits. Of course, integer qualifier is optional. Octal constant similarly is 0 followed by octal digits any number of times followed by integer qualifier optional. Then we have the reserved words if, else, while and switch. So, now we come to the rules section with a %. So, for the 5 reserved 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 reserved words, the action is simply print out the reserved word and then the identifier. So, since we have written down the reserved words and then the identifier, the characters which correspond to these will never be matched against identifier. Whereas, if we have a word such as switches, then even though part of it matches here, it will be the longest match will be that of an identifier. So, if we place the identifier before IF, that is the reserved words here, be sure to try it out once, these 4 will never match, everything matches against the identifier. Now, the hexadecimal constants, when they are caught, the scanf is used to read the integer inside the hexadecimal notation and print it out along with the text. Similarly, octal constants are converted to decimal constants using the scanf function and printed out. Integers are also converted to the normal integer, the characters are converted to normal integer and printed out. Finally, any other character which is caught is ignored. So, dot or new line, they are all ignored. So, this is what we just now went through. So, the patterns are all caught and the output is generated. So, let us look at the floating point numbers, which are a little more complicated than normal integers. So, as usual, we have the lexical analyzer program for floats in C. The digits are 0 to 9 plus, and then we have an exponent which is either big E or small e, followed by plus or minus, it is optional, the sign is optional, followed by digits. So, if we write E plus 9 or E 9, it amounts to the same number, same exponent. Then the blanks, blank, tab or new line any number of times, and floating qualifier is F, F, L, L, right. So, then there are the patterns. So, let us look at the output and then go back to the pattern itself. So, 1, 2, 3, then 3, 4, 5 dot dot, 4, 5, 6, 5 dot 3. So, really the first output is generated here, because we do not catch pure integers, we do not catch anything which does not have a blank after a dot. So, this is ignored. So, 4565.3 is you know optional integer part. So, this could have been a dot 3 as well. 675 e minus is a float with no fraction. Then 523.4 e plus 2 again with optional integer part. Next one is also with optional integer part. 234.3.4 corresponds to 3.4. 234 dot should have had a blank after that. So, it does not. So, that is ignored. 345 dot has a blank. So, that is caught here as optional float with optional fraction. Then dot 34 e plus 09 l is caught as an optional integer, you know, possibly no integer part here, and similarly 987 is without fraction and the last one with optional fraction. So, let us study the patterns here. So, these are the first part. First one is digits followed by exponent followed by optional floating qualifier followed and then followed by blanks. So, remember the look ahead operator. So, this pattern is valid provided it is followed by blanks, otherwise it is not valid. So, this will match float with no fraction. So, digits followed by exponent, okay. So, this is and this of course, is optional. So, this corresponds to floats with no fraction. So, float with no fraction is here 987 e minus 6 f. Here we have a number of digits, you know, 0 to 9 star, 0 or more time iterations here, followed by a dot compulsorily. So, before the dot there can be an integer part or no integer part. So, this is optional integer part, but once there is an optional integer part, we must definitely have digits followed by an optional exponent followed by an optional floating qualifier follow, and of course, it matches only if there are blanks after that. So, the integer part is optional, but the rest is compulsory, at least the digits part is compulsory, exponent is optional. Here we have digits followed by a dot followed by the optional fraction 0 to 9 star, optional exponent, optional floating qualifier, but followed by blanks compulsorily. So, these are the various patterns which match here. So, one with no fraction, second one with optional integer part, third one with optional fraction. Okay. So, these are the various outputs that we already looked at. So, let us look at the another example which is used with the desk calculator as a lexical analyzer to generate a lexical analyzer for the desk calculator, which we are going to study later. Number is 0 to 9 plus followed by a dot optionally. So, this is a dot or a epsilon followed by 0 to 9 star r, sorry, this is a this is r. Okay. So, this is the bar here which gives you two options. So, either 0 to 9 plus followed by a dot or 0 to 9 star followed by a dot then followed by a number of digits. So, the difference between the two is the integer part here is compulsory, whereas the fraction is not. Where here the fraction, the integer part is optional, but the fractional part is compulsory. You cannot have both of them as optional, otherwise you would have just a dot. Name is as usual a to z followed by a to z 0 to 9 star. So, this is the identifier part. So, when a number is caught, it is converted to a number using scanf and it returns a token called number. The value actually is here, so that is read into a variable called yylval dot dval, which is a parser variable. So, I am introducing this example just to show how interfacing with Yaak happens. So, yylval is a parser variable used by Yaak, and this value of number is put into that variable. Whenever there is a name caught, it is looked up in a symbol table, and if the name is present, that pointer is returned true. Otherwise, if the name is absent in the symbol table, it is entered into the symbol table and the token name is returned. For plus plus, we return post plus, minus minus, we return post minus, for a dollar, we return a 0, and new line or any other character, we just return that simple character itself. So, this is just to show you that it is possible to do some symbol table operations along with name search, etcetera, inside a Lex program as well. So, Lex programs can become as technical and as complicated as we want them to be. So, with this background, let us stop the lecture. In the next lecture, we will start studying parsers. Thank you.